used to be smiling.
Well, it is.
Marty is the founder of Montana's Frontier Angel Front. She is known throughout the state as a respected business leader and a smart decision maker. This week, Liz was on Capitol Hill, and yes, she experienced the 100 plus degree in the community.
That's my excuse for a bad hair day.
And she actually was there testifying before John's committee. She was asked to share her expertise on how to create jobs through startup companies. So with that, would you please help me in welcoming Liz.
I'm so happy to be back home in Montana, and it's really fun to be here the day after I testify, or day 2 days later, because my opening remarks and my testimony were the most interesting people I've ever met in my life live in rural America. And we are very rural in Montana, I'm sorry, even in Billings, compared to the Urban Affairs Committee. And my point to the committee was that discovery and innovation are everywhere. We have great people and great ideas everywhere, and it's really incumbent upon them to structure programs and think about our national renewal by capturing the innovation and the spirit of rural Americans, because frankly, you're all entrepreneurs because you had to be to survive. I found the most innovative people in my life here. My friend Diane Smith likes to say, when I moved to DC, I knew 100 patent lawyers and not one inventor. When I moved to Montana within months, I knew 100 of inventors, but only one patent lawyer, Tony Tease, who lives here in Billings, so that's a good thing. Without further ado, this panel is much more interesting than me, and it's so exciting for me to be with my good friend, Becky Reno, who's my favorite woman serial entrepreneur in Montana, because the thing I love the most about Becky is that, as we all do, we learn more from our failures than our successes, even though she's had splendid successes, and I just couldn't be more excited to meet Sarah Calhoun with Red Ants Pants. We also have Jolene, who I hadn't met until today, who's a really well-known leader in her field of landscape architecture. She's done a lot of public facilities. She's worked in Wyoming and in Montana as well, and is growing a wonderful business called Peaks of Plains Design here. And Chris Carpenter, who I have had the pleasure of participating in your services or partaking of your services, the Sanctuary Salon and Spa here in Billings. She has about 40 employees here, runs a really great business, and I think in the world we live in, finding center and peace and well-being is a really great business and solves a very large customer need. So without further ado, I'm going to give each of the panelists 7 or 8 minutes to talk about their fabulous Montana success stories, and I don't think we do enough telling those stories, so take it away, Becky.
I'm Becky Vito, and I own City Brew Coffee. We have a retail roasting company, and we're Billings, Montana based. We have 10 retail locations, storefronts across Montana, and 5 double drive-through kiosks also. So we have 15 locations, 2 of which are beginning entrance into Wyoming. We have a large roasting facility and produce about 4 tons of coffee a week out of our facility on 24th and King. And I also have a wine store called City Vineyard, so if any of you tonight want coffee, I can do it by day and by night. I started in the retail industry, we'll call it, in a different business. Opened my first store in 1980. So I've been doing this for a while, and every day, I think since that day, I have told myself to keep my head down and stay the course, because you can't get distracted and you can't give up. And here in Montana, we're just made out of all the right stuff. And I believe we are. We employ 240 people here in Montana. And I think we're running on all cylinders. Our management team and the front line in our retail stores is the best we've had in 30 years. So it says a lot for what's happening in Montana. We're able to retain a lot of talent. People want to live here, or they want to move back. We just hired a new chief operating officer. He'd been after college away working in different countries and also here in the United States, and he wanted to move back to Billings, Montana, where he was from. So we've been able to really recruit some good people because they want to live here. And if there isn't a better place, you've got to tell me what it is. Kind of my history. We produce an awful lot of coffee, and we hope we delight every customer every day with every experience they have in all the locations we have in Montana and in Wyoming. So, next.
Oh my gosh. Culture questions for the end. We've got a lot of time live for today. So, tell me.
Well, I've got a longer speech than what Becky has, so I'll take her time.
That's great.
when I posted this on our company's Facebook page about the panel called Made in Montana Success Stories, one of my colleagues from college wrote me back and she said, well, you're not technically made in Montana, you're technically made in South Dakota and North Dakota, and then moved to Montana. So she wanted to make sure I did point that out. Like the testers, I am also a farm kid. Grew up on a farm in eastern South Dakota. Hard work, community-minded, small town. I was a kid at 16 on Friday nights where everybody else is going out to a movie. I was the one sitting in the tractor in a grain cart trying to bring in the harvest. Of course, crying my eyes out because I wasn't in the movies. Went to school at North Dakota State. Moved out to Montana in 1999. Moved out here for a job. Didn't want to move to the big cities, Minneapolis, Denver. I really like smaller communities. Worked for a couple of firms here in Billings doing landscape architecture. We don't plant petunias, we do design, so think of what an architect does. Sometimes we call it the architects of the land. And I had an opportunity at the end of 2002, the firm I was working for was essentially going to close down. Just by a job, the principal got offered a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. When I was at that firm, I knew I wanted to own my business someday. I acted like a business owner, even though I was an employee. I wanted to learn all I could about marketing, project management, HR, business management. And so when this firm closed out at the end of 2002, she had a lot of leftover clients. And I thought this was my opportunity if I was going to do it now. And that was in 2003, when I was 26 years old. I picked up her leftover clients, often going and running. One thing about starting a professional services firm, it's all about the relationships and your people. If I had to compete with my former firm, I don't think I ever would have made it, but I was in a great position to pick that up. When you go into your own business, the thing I tell people is make sure you find your passion, make sure you believe in what you're doing, make sure you have a good work ethic, make sure you have good financial credit, and look for opportunities to share resources. One thing I did, instead of just going out and buying a building or renting a big office space, is I actually shared office space with another architecture firm. And so she let me basically buy an office, and I got to use her plotters, and I paid her for that sort of thing. So 8 years later, Peaks of Plains Design is doing work all across Montana and northern Wyoming. About 64% of our work is for public agencies, local, state, and federal government. We got in on the housing boom over in Bozeman. I call it the good times now, 2006. The unique thing over in Bozeman, and developers develop subdivisions, their developers actually pay to put in the park improvements. And I'm really kind of proud to say in Bozeman, I've designed and implemented almost 12 parks for their city system. Other notable projects my firm's worked on, the Yellowstone County Veterans Cemetery over in Laurel. We got to work with the veterans from grassroots efforts. It's actually under national VA consideration. I work at Metro. If you all remember the old stair tunnel, I demolished the stair tunnel. And I'm now putting in a maze to get you down from the upper lot to the lower lot. We hope that you like it. The airport road improvements, all the rock work and landscaping, that's our firm's work. We're putting in a new $1 million park for the small community of Opportunity, Montana. If you don't know where that's at, when you get off the road, off the interstate, and head to Anaconda, it's a little cluster of houses. They're getting custom playground, custom picnic shelters. It's really a wonderful project. We've done management plans for Fish, Wildlife, and Parks, so the Rosebud Park battlefield down there by the Tongue River Reservoir. in Hamilton. We're doing park master plans, and we kind of came into a situation where the staff and the city council wasn't getting along, and we developed a process to kind of get everybody around the table. And by the end of the process, one city council member sat back in her chair, and she said, "This has to be one of the best processes I've ever been involved in." And that was very rewarding, considering at the very beginning they were quite adverse. In Wyoming, we're doing some work in Casper. If you go into Buffalo, Wyoming, we did a wonderful new gateway entry of public art. We did land a federal contract to help design cemeteries for the Veterans Administration. The lead is out of Rapid City, but we look forward to helping the VA design cemeteries all across the United States. And we did neighborhood planning in Butte. We stand up in these two neighborhoods and ask these people what do they want from their community. One gentleman stood up and I thought, oh no, he's gonna go, it's gonna be one of those. And he said, "Actually, in the 72 years I've lived in Butte, this is the first time I've ever been asked what I want in my neighborhood." And he said, "Thank you for that." And of course, we were able to be the conduit to help them out with that. So we're doing wonderful projects all across the United States and the region. When we do our projects, we live by some strong values that our firm is based on. Strong communities, conflict resolution, bringing people from conflict to resolution. We appreciate working in grassroots efforts. And of course, we want to make happy, healthy spaces in our communities, and that's done through good design. My firm is an 8A firm, a woman-owned business, so we're looking for those federal opportunities that are set aside for that. And frankly, we've made it through our first recession. Woo-hoo! So that's good. We do get involved in the community. I encourage people who work for me to get involved. Been involved with Zonta Club of Billings. We do good work. The advice that I wanted to give people is find a mentor or a business coach. They help you out tremendously. Be an advocate. I go to Washington, D.C. on an annual basis through my professional association. I get to always meet with the senator's staff. Senator Testers, the only one that I've met personally on every trip when I'm in D.C. I appreciate his time for that. Find your passion, and of course, thank your family. You can't do this, like she was saying, without your better halves, and that includes my husband Jason and my daughter Abigail, who's four. And when we do our projects, I have my personal values. I hold to them very strongly. Honesty, tell your clients what they need to hear, even though it hurts. Do your work with integrity. Do what's best for the greater good. And reap the rewards of ownership. Even though it's stressful and sometimes take a toll both mentally and physically, there's nothing greater than owning your own business. Thank you.
I'd never been to Montana before. It struck me as a good place to live, and So I moved in, I bought a book called How to Start a Business for Dummies. I didn't even know what a business plan was at this point. So I was reading this literally the first weekend in town. I lucked out with a job peeling logs. And I was sitting downtown reading this book, and a guy noticed what I was reading, and we got to talking. And it turns out for the past 20 years, he had done production and design for Patagonia, a little outdoor company you might be familiar with. And I was sitting there, like, pinching myself, wondering how I got so lucky. So he took me to his shop a week later, gave me loads of contacts and advice, and he just said, Sarah, you're onto something big here. You need to move on this now. And that was, again, fall of 04. And his name is Richard Sibrell. He's still in Bozeman, still designing for a bunch of outdoor companies, and he's on my board of advisors to this day. He's been a phenomenal mentor. And like you said, having good mentors is a huge, huge part of this. So from there, it took about 2 years to get the design of the pants, the website created, the name, the funding, the the whole business plan and the strategy of how we're going to market this new product and build a brand from the ground up with absolutely zero experience in the apparel industry, which is not a very easy industry to enter with no experience. I will warn you of that. So after about a year in Bozeman, it was a little bit too big of a town for me, and I wanted to be in a more ranching-based ag town. And I read Ivan Doig's book, This House of Sky, which is a phenomenal read, and he grew up in good old White Sulphur Springs, so I drove to this little ranching town, and it struck my fancy, and I bought an old brick building, used to be a saddle shop right on Main Street there. The real estate is somewhat more affordable in White Sulphur than it was. If you can believe that. So they really lucked out, and I to this day still live right behind the shop with my cat and chickens and my dog. And White Sulphur is also not the best place to find a husband, I found out. So this whole piece about depending on your partner, I'm still looking forward to learning. So as far as getting things going, I opened the doors in fall of 06, so I'm heading into this is my fifth year in business right now. And I took somewhat of a non-traditional approach to the business model. We only sell directly to the customer, so one pair at a time. We don't go through any retail stores. And the reason for that is I want to maintain that personal connection with our customers. I think people are definitely looking for that level of authenticity and that connection. Which I really value. So we're keeping that on, and we would have to sell so much more volume for the middleman to get their cut. So far that's working well. But that being said, we have to work really, really hard about getting the word out there, establishing the brand, making it a known phrase, Red Am's Pants, which is good. The name's worked out. People tend to remember the name. And the reason for that name, there's a funny image on our website you should check out, but in an ant colony, it's actually the female ants that do all the work. the male ants just breed and die. We're getting production going. We found a U.S. manufacturer. We're definitely never going overseas for our production. I tried to find contract cut and sew facilities in Montana. No one had the right equipment, unfortunately. But we're in Seattle, so we're still in the Northwest. We source our fabric from India, which is a pain in the butt. Importing is not fun, but there's not cotton canvas made in the States anymore. So those mills are shutting down left and right, which is a real shame. So we get all the production done out there. It gets shipped to our international headquarters in White Sulphur Springs, where we have our storefront, our retail area, my office, and our distribution center, which is all just corners of a big room. And so we ship all over the world from there, which is really neat. The pants do get all over, a lot to Antarctica, Greenland, Australia, Europe. So then the challenge is, now that we have all these pants and I have this great little store, how do we get the word out? So the marketing has been the really, really fun part. I think it's neat to be able to really use your creativeness and sense of humor to try to get the word out, and it's worked well. What we've done is establish something called Tour de Pants. And I got an old Airstream trailer. We painted ants all over the outside of it, and got a beer sponsor, Big Sky Brewery out of Missoula. And so we go on the road. I hired a gal to go with me, and we do house parties, much like a Tupperware party, but I like to think of them as a little bit cooler. So we bring our pants and our beer and a fun slideshow and tell our story and meet our customers face-to-face, listen to their stories, and really connect with folks down the way. And it's been wonderful. And there's, you know, it's a smaller market point. We might sell 10, 15 pairs a night, but our costs are minimal, and it's so much fun. And once people, you know, get involved with it and make it personal with us, they tend to be customers for life. It's almost a cult following now. It's unbelievable. The feedback we're getting from customers blows your mind, laughing and tears and these amazing stories from all over the country, which has been really fun. So other things we do for marketing, we do fashion shows on bars. Family friendly, but very, very fun. We've got some fun commercials online. You should check those out on our website. We've built demolition derby cars and had women drivers, and we've won. We built a bucking ant for the afloat in the Miles City Bucking Horse Parade. Much like a mechanical bull, but so we had a girl riding an ant in the parade, and just a lot of fun things like that. And the newest event you might have heard about is the first annual Red Ants Pants Music Festival next weekend in White Sulphur Springs. We've got Lyle Lovett and his large band coming, Jerry Jeff Walker, Rodney Crowell, Guy Clark, a slew of great performers. So if you don't have anything going on, come on up to White Sulphur. We're doing it in a cow pasture, and tomorrow we'll be out there with all our local high school students picking up cow patties, billing goals. So that's a really, it's been a really neat part of it, having a headquarters in a really small town. And those of you who do live in rural areas, there's a neat component to just, you know everybody, you know the resources, everyone pitches in, whether it's an auger or a hydraulic tamper or the logpole post or the tents or this or that, you know, someone to come in to mow the place. You know, everywhere you turn, people are, oh, I can do that, I got that, we'll help out. You know, it's been a really neat community-based project for sure. And it's going to bring a lot of money into a little town that's struggling, which is very exciting. And on the side, I started a foundation this spring, the Red Ants Pants Foundation. We're still in the developing stages, but it's in support of family farms and ranches, women in business, and rural initiatives. So all the proceeds from this event will go to the foundation, which is a neat element. Granted, we're still working on breaking even this year, so don't get any big ideas that Red Ants Pants is having so much money that we can give it away. But so now I have one nonprofit when you can have two. So that's the big summary. It's been a challenge. I definitely, if I knew what I was getting into, I don't think I would have had the guts to do it, but I'm very glad that I was naive entering the business world. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of fun, and it's been neat to be able to kind of think outside the box, because I didn't even know what the box was as far as business. Future things, I would love to get production in the state, even in White Sulphur, if we can get that far. I would also love to add a wool line using Montana sheep, which I think would be a really neat way to connect the ag community with our products. So. Lots of exciting projects down the line. Stay tuned, redantsfans.com. And again, the festival next weekend. We've got a bunch of info out there on the table if you want to take any out. So thank you so much.
Good morning. I don't know about you, but I'm going to sign up for a shirt of pants. Very feeling. So if everybody wants to come, I'll be signing up for one soon. I'm on a pair of those. My name is Chris Carpenter, and I was born and raised here in Billings. I had an entrepreneurial seizure about 13 years ago, and my life changed dramatically with that moment when that thought came in. And for a lot of us, there is, you can almost pinpoint it to the moment it happened to you where you couldn't live your life like you used to and you had to do something. And it was really, you know, having enough guts to make the decision. Mind you, I had no idea what I was doing, but I made the decision anyway. And I was a hairdresser. I'd been a hairdresser for about 10 years and dreamed of having a place in Billings where you could go and get a massage and a facial and a pedicure, maybe a manicure, get your hair done. And prior to that, my experience had pretty been I would create my own spa days, but you would go from one place to another. You'd go to massage therapist, you'd run to an esthetician, you'd run around town and you could do it, but it wasn't exactly the most relaxing experience in the end after the whole day spent jogging around finding your spa place. Whenever I traveled, I went to every city I went to a spa. I was an addict. And so it was perfect that, you know, I figured out how to do it. I wouldn't recommend what I did to anyone going into business. There's a lot easier ways of doing it, but I signed an intent to lease, didn't know it was a binding legal agreement, had no idea what I was getting into, but I'm really determined and I'll work harder than most people I know. So it happened, and I'm a dreamer. I just dreamed about a place where we could take care of women, that they could come in and be taken care of, even if it was for an hour a day. They give, they take care of their family, they work. Just to have a place where they could stop the madness and just come back to themselves. And that's what Sanctuary is for me and still is to this day. It's been quite an experience. I had to learn about business. I didn't know what a profit and loss statement was. I had no idea how to read one. I just was a hard worker and because of that, was able to really create a lot. But I did seek out people to learn from, took classes, filled in where my gaps were. It was a lot of work and a lot of fun. I've had a great experience. We've grown. We have about 4,000 square feet, half a salon, half a spa. Really, really enjoy education. It's probably one of the primary reasons for having my business. I love to learn. I love my staff to be able to learn and grow. So we constantly are doing education, going to education. For me, that's something that never stops. I love to keep growing and finding out what's new. And an advantage of being in Montana actually is I can watch what happens nationally and internationally in my industry, see what's happening, let other people test drive it, and it's still new here a year or two later. People say it's crazy, but I think it's one of the best things about living here. And you can find out a lot from other people. I've found mentors, I've found people in the industry, and one thing that I'd really tell people is, you know, just ask. I have found the people at the level where I'd like to be are so willing to give you advice, help you find resources, let you know things, so just ask. And I'm a dreamer. I, last year, had an idea. I just really wanted to do a gift store and kept thinking, you know, this is fun. I love to give gifts. It's really fun. I enjoy shopping for them. I enjoy giving them. So why not? I love it to open a store. So in recession times, I decided to open a gift store. Once again, didn't really know what I was doing, but you know, there's clues. If you look at people who are successful and figure out what they do, and all you have to do is really copy it, it works. So, you know, another tip would just be copy successful people. They knew what they were doing. Don't copy the people who aren't successful. So it's, you know, and they leave you clues all the time. If you just listen, you can do fairly well. It's been a great journey. We have had a ball. It's called The Joy of Living. And it's our tagline is inspire gifts that are as much fun to give as they are to receive. It's really a girlfriend gift store is what I call it, whether your girlfriend's you or someone else. So we really, really have fun. A few months later, I was once again having another slight entrepreneurial seizure while I was at a market and said, gosh, you know, why not have a kids' store? So in 30 minutes, my friend and I in the aisle of the gift store wrote our kind of business plan vision of what this store could be. So The Joy of Kids is my second store that I opened when people said you shouldn't probably be doing anything because we're in a recession. Don't believe people. It's you know, so much of it's in our mind and how we perceive things, and what you see is what you create. So if you see something and you're passionate about it and you have the energy around it and you know your market, I mean, you also really need to know who you're building for. I mean, my businesses are all for women. I know, you know, how to take care of women, and there's many, many ways. So I never do things that don't have to do with that core vision of taking care of women.
We do free gift wrap. We do everything we can to make it really, really easy for women to come, enjoy themselves. We help them find what's the perfect thing for them, whether it's a haircut, a gift, something for the grandchild. I also have a really, really strong core to all my businesses that is community involvement. There was a point in my businesses where everyone kept asking us to donate things, to give things, and I really, for a long time, tried to hide from everybody. After a while, it was kind of like, seriously, I have no money. We're trying to pay our bills, and how am I going to do this? And when I finally had a moment where I realized, wait a minute, this isn't going to go away. You have to figure out how to make this work. And we switched it and became a core of our business is giving back to the community. Advertising dollars were transformed to looking at giving back to causes in our community, especially things that have to do with women, children, the arts, theater, things that I think are vital for a really vibrant community. We really, really focus on giving back in those ways. And it's worked. It's worked in that, you know, we just get to do more of what we love to do when we give. Givers get. And it's created opportunities, created relationships. I don't see it ever ending. I mean, whenever we do things now, I think about how can we help? How can we take this event we're going to do? Who can we help with it? What can we do? So it's really been an important part of how I've moved forward with business. It's given me personally incredible opportunities to meet people I would never have met, go places I would have never gone. You know, just by being involved, being active, knowing what's going on. So, you know, you really have to network as many ways as you can, as many people as you can. But for me, it's at the end of the day, it's always about the woman, whoever she is. Everything we design, everything we do is for her. So that's where my passion really lies. And I don't think we're over, it's over yet. I'm a dreamer. I got some other things just kind of brewing. So thank you.
Your board of advisors and your people helping you initially with your businesses. How do you pay them when your business is just beginning, or when you don't have a large capitalization, or you don't have an angel fund to say, I love your idea, I appreciate what you're doing, but you need to have somebody come on board with you to fill in the gaps that you don't personally bring to the table?
Good question. Well, I can say how I pay mine, and it's we do a float trip every year and discuss our issues, and then I give them engraved Red Ants Pants flasks.
For us, or for myself, I guess I should say, I actually don't pay my business coaches. What I ended up doing, I mentioned the Zonta Billings. It's a woman, I call it kind of like a women's rotary organization. There's over 40 women in this organization from very diverse professions, from attorneys to accountants to business coaches to everything else. And Chris actually helped support that organization with some of her stuff, thank you. And through the networking and good friends and good relationships that way, you gain a lot of advice. And if you can find an organization like that, whether it's Rotary or something else, that's a good way to do it, especially when you're starting out.
I learned how to fish. It's a bit, really. Because I don't golf, but to have people come to Montana, everyone's so fascinated. Montana's a brand. People want to come here. And to get some people that have vast experience from large organizations, they love to come to Montana and they love to fish. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing if you'll just arrange similarly a float trip or, you know, a fishing trip for them, and, you know, have them outside and let them camp, and camping to them is usually some really nice lodge, and they bring the wine and stuff. But it really, honest answer, you can bring people to Montana if you just invite them. They want to come here, and they want to experience what we have. They want to be here.
And I joined a lot of national organizations in my, you know, trade, and found people, connections through that. People, a lot of people don't want to charge you for giving you, you know, their expertise. There's many, many people who are happy to just share it with you. That's what I say, you just have to ask.
And be completely fearless. Our annual fund has looked at almost 300 businesses over the last 5 years, and I'm going to, and with all due respect and apologies to the men in the office, but this is sort of the extreme way a woman pitches versus a man. They'll come in, they'll go, I've got the greatest idea in the world. I'm going to cure cancer, and you are so lucky to be able to invest $1 million in it. A woman will come in, and they will have a 47-page business plan. They will have thought about what color the doorknobs are going to be. And they will be phenomenal. They will know their customer to the core, because the most important thing in any business is be very close to your customer. They will tell you everything you need to know. Everything you need to know about your business, your customer will tell you. And we go out and say, don't do a thing until you talk to 50 potential customers. Don't build your product. Don't open your storefront. Don't pick your doorknobs. Your customers will tell you everything you need to know. But so this piece about picking up the phone and being fearless and, you know, sitting outside of somebody's door, at the end of the day, business people love that, because they know it takes that kind of ballsy guts to get, you know, keep it going. It's hard. And don't forget that making money allows you to sustain whatever your passion and dream is. So that's a real big piece of it. We tend to think nonprofit, because that's really not what motivates a lot of people in their businesses, is money. But yeah, make money. You really do. But don't just be absolutely fearless. What's the worst that can happen?
Well. You fall out of the boat. I mean,
they could push you. They could push you.
All right, well, I'm going to ask Becky a question, because the first time I met Becky, oh, yeah, I love it. We are so afraid of failing. And I want you to talk about your first business.
Oh, yeah. Well, failure is always, you know, something you have to think about. I started, the first business I started in 1980, I owned some video stores. Fairly regional, larger size, providing video programs for grocery stores. And we had storefronts, but they were just in Montana. And I was not 30 years old yet, and an advisor recommended that we meet this company that had a blind pool of cash to help us grow, and we could do an upward merger on a stock trade. And so I used the stock certificate subsequently, after having to take the company through Chapter 11, to wallpaper my bathroom. So it was only humor I could find. That's all they didn't take from me. But I will tell you that you have to be careful out there, how you raise your capital. And who you join with. That was I was very young, so it was great. I was so naive. Of course, you didn't quit. You kept going, but it's dangerous. And I don't mean to. You know, right now there are. It's hard. Where capital is being rationed, in my opinion. You know, we're looking at other areas on how we can grow our businesses without going to a bank. I think we more than not probably fear the lending sort of platform more than we ever have.
because it's new, it's the same, it's just changed a lot, especially if you're, you know, older in business like myself and have had a traditional relationship for a long time. So I just, you know, I just caution all of you to be careful who you do business with, because there is a lot of money out there that people would like to invest in you because they know how hard you work. They know that you have a great idea and execution's key, but sometimes the price to pay for that capital is much, much higher than the success that you'll realize from owning your business. So choose your partners.
Well, we actually don't like to talk about money as women sometimes, so I think that's all we should talk about. But I really want, I mean, I think understanding the capital food chain and the smart capital for your business, I'd like for each of you, you've talked about your ideas, you've talked about your passions, I want you to talk about the money that, and how you started, you require you a source of capital to start your businesses.
Yep, I sure
did.
I did.
I like to talk, so I have to be careful not to dominate the conversation.
That won't be a problem today.
Actually, in my business, the tough thing about being a professional services industry is that I don't manufacture or make things. So that's the good news. The bad news is everything that my business forms around is up here. It's called intellectual property. So when you go into business, really, it's not a whole lot to start things up because it's basically what you can do with your hand and a piece of paper. However, there are things like software and equipment and things like that. So most of my startup money was from personal savings and hitting the market at the right time and just creating money. So from there, I do have a line of credit now at the bank to get us through. And but it is interesting for me to go in and you know, say, can I get a line of credit? And they're like, okay, well, what's your assets? And I'm like, well, got some computer software that was outdated 6 months ago. I've been feeling a little ill because I'm kind of stressed out today, but not a whole lot. So it does make it a challenge to, you know, I kind of look at other architecture engineering firms, and it kind of seems like, you know, they end up buying a building or building a building. I'm assuming that the real estate associated with the firm helps create that platform for assets to leverage against lending, and just haven't got to that point yet. I'm not sure, you know, if I necessarily need to get to that point.
Don't buy a building.
Unless it's in White Salt.
I agree.
I also, well, I had some savings and then borrowed privately. I spoke with some bankers in Bozeman, and to their credit, I'm sure they were wondering what I was thinking when I walked in. You know, these stodgy old man bankers, they were like, workwear for women, they've already workwear for men, what do you need this for? I was just like, can you just bring the lady banker out, please? But the interest rates were much higher than I could find privately, so I went ahead and did that. And with a manufacturing business, there is a lot of cash tied up in inventory. A lot, to the point where every time the bills come in every month, I've tried so hard to get Northwestern Energy to trade pants for power, and they're not happy. Sales cash flow is always tight, but
they don't get there's power in pants.
I started. I did get a traditional loan with a local bank, and you know, partnered for years with local bank. It's a lot tougher now. It's a lot harder to get the money you need. You pretty much have to sign off your firstborn, sometimes your second, to do it. It really is. If you don't have no collateral, you don't get the loan traditional period. So I also used, you know, our personal savings to open my last two businesses. I just keep telling my husband, I said, you know that thing called retirement, it's called inventory now. And that's true, that's part of it. I mean, it is, you take a lot of risk. And that's one thing that, you know, when people look at you, everything looks fine, but at the end of the day, I say, you know, I'm the one who goes to sleep with it and wakes up with it, you know, first in mind, how are you managing everything? And it takes diligence and being careful and, you know, making sure you have enough cash. And there's times it's tough, but you just have to always be super creative. But it, you know, it's a lot tighter, it's a lot tougher now.
Please, we do have a couple of questions. I tried to get the bank my first form, blue paper. A few of you up there, I think what your businesses are doing, you compete against sort of national chains, Starbucks, well, I'm sure it's a dirty word to you.
No, but we steal lots of ideas.
Yeah. How do you, I guess, compete against them essentially with a, you know, a small entrepreneur budget, you know, small town? How do you compete against those, you know, the Starbucks and the Carhartts and the international chains that you just can't even come close to?
Such a good question, because in our meetings with our people every year, we do a strategic meeting, and it's just everybody sitting around trying to figure out ways that we can differentiate our brand. That's what we call it. So what sets us aside from Starbucks is our, certainly who we're thinking of at it from a retail platform. And so generally, the ideas that we come up with come with everybody who works the front line every single day. You know, the thousands and thousands of drinks we serve a day. Those, you know, our staff members and our management have been instrumental. The other thing is that we shop, not in Montana, because I think my pictures up in their back rooms, but we do shop Starbucks very heavy, mostly, you know, in Western, Northern Idaho and Eastern Washington for the most part, and try to understand what's changed in their store since we had the last visit. So we've been doing that for 10 years. You know, what are they doing? And then I come home and we have our meetings and talk about how can we be different. So our holiday rollout this year, for example, please don't tell them, is we will have coffee in a tin that's reusable, you know, both on the grocery shelf and in our retail stores. Just something to keep that customer enjoying. You know, coffee is so personal. And we believe that because of our roast profiles and a million other things. If you want to come watch us roast, I have the best job in the world. And I love it more than anything. Although I'm our acting CFO right now, so I don't like it at all. But it's been, you know, differentiating. What do you have? How can you differentiate yourself from, you know, a brand? You know, we're involved a little bit in a radio station called Mojo Radio. That's helped us. You know, so who can you partner with? And it's about your name, you know, and it's about what happens when they walk in your store or get on your website. Our website is antiquated, but I'm going to go to Red Ant's Pants and get some good ideas. And we want to be in the parade with you next year.
I actually just had a comment on more on financing. Don't get discouraged. Finance has been a long, long, long time. I mean, we tried to start running our business. We started in July. We didn't get a bond until finally February. And finally you go, how long am I going to put my life on hold for this? How bad do I really want this? But we started out with one bank in town. And we got almost through the whole entire process. And I decided, you know, the things aren't going like I want. I'm making this jump through more loopholes than I think are worthy. And so we actually switched banks at the very end of our deal. And I sometimes feel bad about that because we got a lot of advice from the first bank. But, you know, to make the deal, we went to the other one. And so finding a good relationship with the bank is really important. And being with someone you feel you can work with is also very important. And I know everyone gets discouraged, even I do still these days. But you got to really want it. And you got to really be able to willing to work hard for it and seek out other things if things aren't going the way you want. And like, you don't be afraid. The worst I can say is no. I'm here no different spot than where we started. So this is the banking line.
So Sarah, has Carhartt tried to buy your company yet?
No, and they won't get it.
Never say never.
Yeah. It was actually interesting. I found out, I got tipped off about 6 months before I opened my doors that they were coming out with a women's line, and they came out a month before I opened up. Which it ended up being fine because they didn't do a good job designing their pants, in my opinion. I've heard that from loads of people. And what's, you know, I think to answer your question is you make a better product. have better customer service and really give the customers what they want, whether it's the branding experience of being part of Red Ant's Pants and all these other ways. You know, we have a little red ant tag on every pair of pants, and they're in a different place on every pair, and you've got to find your matching ant out there. So you know, when you see someone else wearing Red Ant's Pants, you go meet them, you connect. You find it, if you have your matches in the same place, you both get a free t-shirt, we've got like 35 matches, but it's those kind of things that it makes it more personal and you know, little creative silly things like that that can make people more loyal to your brand versus the Carhartt. Their price point is lower, they're made in China. But about 8 months after I opened, I got an online order from Dearborn, Michigan. For a pair of Curvy, a pair of Straight, a t-shirt, a sweatshirt, like everything we had. And I was like, whoa, this person's really excited, you know, and I happened to be out of that size t-shirt, so I called my online customer, which doesn't usually happen. I got a voicemail, thank goodness, and it was, hey, this is Nicole Miller with Carhartt, please leave a message. I drank a lot of whiskey, and then proceeded to call that Patagonia guy, one of my mentors, and I was like, oh, calm down. He's like, they're doing their research, they're checking out their qualifications, they're going to pull apart the pants at the seams, see what you're doing differently and better, and they might try to buy you out, you know, so they're well aware of us, but I haven't had any official offers yet.
But don't say no.
What do you do to keep staff for so long in a retail environment?
Great question. Sometimes it doesn't seem like we retain them as long as I would like to. You know, it's an interesting challenge. But I think a lot of it is, Marilyn, is really, you know, caring for the people. My thing is I take care of women. I take care of my staff, create opportunities for them. My average service provider makes over $20 an hour. You know, in my industry, that isn't really expected. We pay them as well as we can. We give them opportunities. We have 401k, they have health insurance, we have paid vacation. We have opportunities for them. And I really take care and create opportunities for those who have been with me longer term. I mean, it's really, that's where I drive benefits is to really, because they created the business. I didn't create the business. I created the opportunity. They created the business. And if they don't take care of the guests and keep the guests coming back, I don't have a business. So they're, you know, their goal.
You know, Marilyn, most recently, these last 4 years during this recession, our retention has been better just because we've been in a recession, I will tell you that. Because people aren't as mobile as they were. I mean, a lot of talented people, but I will tell you the one big changing moment in our company, especially from the management level and then above them, is we're really transparent. We decided to disclose all financial information at every level on each company to that management team, and it has helped enormously. And we believe that's one of the reasons we're still here and made it through the recession.
One of my favorite businesses in Whitefish, he has always said, customers inform your product or your service, and they'll tell you about that. But the only thing that will keep customers is if you take care of your employees. And that's just absolutely the most critical part of really being the scale of business.